Zorich and I'm moderator for this session, which just means I have the honor of introducing our illustrious panel, whose names are up here. This, you may have seen this diagram somewhere in your work life, and if not, you're going to see it many times today. But this is a graphic that was developed by the Digital Curation Center in the UK, and it's their lifecycle management graphic, and it's a little daunting. If you find it too daunting, you might prefer this one better. This is a cartoon. We're all going to have this cartoon. People have found this pasted on their doors. It's making the rounds of anybody who's involved in digital curation or data curation. What I put it here for in the beginning is because I felt that Adams could have stopped after the fifth panel. You are not worthy, if you don't know what this means. But in fact, you are all very worthy, and if you don't understand what it means, this group is going to explain it to you today. So let me introduce the panelists without further ado. The order in which they're going to speak is the order in which I'll introduce them. Right to my immediate right, your left, is Chuck Patch, who is a consultant in museum information management. He's a former MCM president. And he's going to talk about what data curation is and why it matters, particularly in the museum context. Following him will be Dr. Helen Tibbo, who's the Alumni Distinguished Professor at the School of Information and Library Sciences at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. And she has worked with many grant agencies to develop a digital curators program at the school. And she's going to talk about that and about the skill sets that are involved in being using or doing data curation. And finally, we'll have Günter Waibel, who's in the center here. He's the director of the Digitization Program Office at the Smithsonian Institution. And he's going to talk about the economics, what's driving this new push towards data curation, as well as how it plays out in the larger ecosystem of museums and libraries and archives and cultural heritage organizations. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Chuck, and I'm going to move here so that the panelists have more space. And at the end, Len Steinbach, who's sitting right here, is going to be what I've called our provocateur. He's going to open up the Q&A session and lead that discussion. Okay?
So. Just before the session started, we were talking among ourselves about this term, digital curator, and how this is probably going to be the first major impediment that we're going to run into in instituting this role in museums. It's just sort of a hot button issue, and my prediction is that in the next 10 years, this role of digital curator and the process of digital curation will find its way into the museum community, but nobody is ever going to be called a digital curator. So, you know, when we define that word, here's this morning's stupid phony pop quiz. The question is, what is digital curation? Is it digital preservation, digital asset management, archiving, all these various functions that go on in cultural institutions and many normal business institutions that involve managing digital assets? And the answer is really that it's all of the above. Digital curation is really a form of management, and it deals with the entire scope of managing digital assets in whatever form. And we have to be careful right at the outset that when we talk about digital assets, I'm not talking about digital images, I'm not talking about video necessarily, I'm talking about everything that's digital that we create in our institutions, and that's a lot of stuff that we normally leave out of that definition. So there are lots of definitions of digital curation floating around out there. A nice succinct one that Joyce Ray came up with. She's a professor at the Johns Hopkins Museum Studies Program, where we're developing a digital curation program, and Diane, that will be the only plug that I make. And the simple one-line definition here is that digital curation is the active and ongoing management of digital assets throughout their life cycle, and obviously there's an including there. It includes the creation of high-quality resources that can be found and used effectively. Now, the important things to take out of that is first that it begins at the point where a digital asset is created. And that one of the aspects of high quality, a high quality resource, is that it can be found and used effectively. So this implies, by definition, really, that we're going to provide contextual information, descriptive information, all of the stuff that we need to be able to take that thing that we create, use it again, and keep using it for a long period of time. The identification of those resources with long-term value is another aspect of digital curation. And what we're learning, what that tells us right away, is that we're identifying things we want to save, and it means at the same time that we're identifying stuff that we don't want to save. This weeding out process. And then we have the preservation, the long-term preservation of assets, and according with emerging standards and best practices, which are always emerging and always changing and require constant monitoring. Why we want to do this? Well, one of the things that reasons that was given by the Blue Ribbon Task Force on Sustainable Digital Preservation last year was the increase of information, digital information, in relationship to the available storage that we're creating. And the blue line there is the information that we're creating. The red line is the available storage that we're producing. And see that it's accelerating. That's a sort of interesting alarmist thing, and I'm not sure that it's going to be that important to people here, but anybody who, of course, has been involved in managing any form of digital assets knows perfectly well that the saw about, disk storage is becoming so much cheaper, this is not, a big deal anymore. Knows that, of course, while the disk storage has become enormously cheaper, the assets, even on an individual basis, have become enormously larger, and there are many, many more of them, and we are no longer in the realm of the 380K JPEG that we need to save. Another aspect of things that are going on in this new digital, it's not new, but it's this evolving digital era that we're in, that I think has a kind of interesting, is kind of an interesting tangent to me for museums and the whole business of collecting assets in the future, is the way we have begun really completely decoupling certain activities that were normal and that we expected with physical objects. And the thing that's happened most recently, of course, is the decoupling of social uses of media from their preservation. The simplest example that I can think of here is the family picture album. This is a device that was really invented for sharing social material, social stuff. It just happened to function really well, or reasonably well, as a preservation device. 50 years after it was created, you could go into the attic and discover what your mom looked like when she was a kid. And this already began to change when we went to digital cameras, and up in the attic now you might find shiny discs that people thought maybe have been used as coasters during odd holidays that are no longer celebrated. And in the past 3 years, we've completely assigned this function of social sharing to commercial cloud-based services like Facebook, Flickr, and so forth. And I would wager that vast majority of images that are up there in the cloud are only located down on people's smartphones. So this is an area that is a problem in terms of future collecting. And we're also doing this with the cloud as well in our own institutions by moving data storage to the cloud. And that, in a sense, is risky, but it emphasizes one aspect of the digital curation process, which is that when you do this, you have to protect yourself, and institutions can do this through service level agreements and so forth, but it really emphasizes the importance of being able to migrate your data when you need to, if you are dependent on services outside your own walls. Is that clinking something in it? So what needs to happen for digital curation to work is that you have to develop activities and policies that enhance the data quality, the context, essentially what I've written here. this is from Joyce. And the, be able to retrieve them and keep this life cycle going. One of the great sources for information on digital curation, and I'm sorry about how huge and busy this slide is, but I'll unpack it a bit for you here. There's a really good source of information for a lot of this stuff called the Digital Curation Center in the UK, and just about all of us will talk about it in some institution in some respect in the next hour or so. But they have defined these steps dealing with the life cycle, digital curation life cycle, and not enough coffee yet. The processes that where we conceptualize and conceive of the plans that we're going to do. I'm going to look at these in terms of where we are at, I think, in general, in the museum community. Generally, when we talk about, when you hear discussions of digital curation, we start dealing with what's going on down there at the ingest level. I mean, people immediately, it seems to me, jump to the concept of the digital repository and the whole preservation aspects of ingest. And so forth. I think in terms of what we do in museums, we're kind of stuck in the top half of this diagram. It's not a diagram, it's a list of processes. This is the chart, the diagram that you will see, and people will go into it in more detail, but the basic concept here is that you have a digital object that's created, and at the point of creation, you begin encasing that object in various levels of information and activity. So immediately surrounding that core object, you have metadata that describes what it is, that describes how it's going to be presented. Around that, you have activities for preservation planning. Then you have this curatorial process in which you appraise what you need and weed out what you don't need. Among all those things are these activities that are really important, the creating or receiving of information, the appraisal process in which you determine what it is that's important about that. You bring it into a repository where, at which point you might transform it if it's in a proprietary format that needs to be changed, and you take whatever preservation aspects of it, and it is iterative. You continue to do this. It's not something that ever stops, really. This is when, in doing this in the museum community, I think that, you know, we're beginning to get a handle on this idea of conceptualizing the problem. We're beginning to eat away at the issues of creating the digital assets, and this is pretty much coming from the area of digital asset management. Where I think we really kind of fall down is in appraising and selecting the material that we plan to preserve. Done it well in certain areas. We've done it well. We're starting to do it well with digital asset management, but in the whole area of documentation, the creation of information surrounding objects and the processes in our museums, we don't really, in most cases, pay much attention to that. And until we do, that whole issue of ingest preservation action and reappraisal and so forth is sort of a moot point. One of the reasons this happens is we have kind of this is my great graphic ability is showing here, is that we still have in a lot of museums, and this is changing slowly, but there still is a kind of balkanization of areas where people manage different kinds of data, and it tends each of these groups will acquire their own systems, and surprisingly often they don't really communicate very much, so. These are the areas that I think that we tend to find in most museums at this point. I'll get to the lower right-hand corner in a second. But you have the collections information management system, a term that I prefer over a collections management system because it really is about collections information and helps us disambiguate it from content management systems, which was the next major area to come in. We now have digital asset management, and we're beginning to see records and document management. systems coming into museums. But these tend to be owned by different departments. Anybody who's been in a traditional museum knows perfectly well that the incredibly competent, elaborate collections information management system is almost always used to create tombstone data that nobody ever sees and only a few people in the institution ever get to touch. Content management systems largely are run out of web departments. The DAMs generally somewhere in the photography or digital imaging department, and the constituency for records and document management tends to be administrative. And what you really find in most places is this situation where you have these large systems beginning to get a hold of various kinds of data, and then you have these kind of skunk works projects going on all over the place where somebody has a really rich load of data running on a FileMaker Pro database and back in their cubicle or in their office somewhere. Maybe four or five of the essential people know about it, and nobody else is aware of it, and of course it never gets into any truly accessible place. Part of this is because most of us are still operating on a kind of classic archival records management frame of mind where everything where nothing is important until it gets to paper. And then we know how to handle it. And the thing about paper is, of course, it passively preserves. I mean, I've got stuff on my desk that I've had there since, 2006, but, it's not degrading. But the idea, what goes on in this is this classic process is that you create the object, you probably have policies for what you're supposed to do with it, retention schedules for record organization and stuff, and then it reaches the end, and this is important because this doesn't happen with digital data, there's never an end, it reaches the end of its useful life, and then the archivist or records manager steps in and begins to handle the process to either destroy inessential materials or to preserve it. So the way we end up acting is the important stuff gets printed out and it gets filed according to whatever policies they are, and all kinds of stuff that would be very interesting to keep that are essentially analogous to scientific data sets in some cases. Basically the background information, the stuff that you would really like to know that would contextualize object information and so forth, is left to the individual user, and that's not their job necessarily, especially without guidance. So decisions about how to organize files, file directories, where to put those directories, how to back them up if they're not on a server, file naming conventions, all that stuff is done by individuals. And the consequences of that is exactly what you would expect. And this is, all no-brainer stuff. The files frequently have version problems. You can't go on the basis of what the modification dates are. Somebody comes in after you, it's really hard to figure out what's going on. The filing and categorization of this stuff is really, really idiosyncratic. And these are all, the results of not having the same of policies about managing the digital stuff that we do for classical paper stuff. And then there's this problem that, of course, a lot of digital data just doesn't flatten out onto a piece of paper or actually function very well. It wouldn't reduce to a PDF. So you can't print out time-based media like videos and audio files. CAT files can be converted into multi-layered Acrobat files, but once you've done that, that's what they are, and you can't alter them. Work with them very well. In classic records management, the classic records management world, that's exactly the way you would like to have them. But in terms of digital curation, you would like to keep using that information for various uses. You would like to leverage that in the future for things that the original creators may never have thought of using them for. And scientific data sets, and this is an area I think is kind of interesting because take a slight detour here and say that digital curation and repositories really kind of grew out of the scientific community when they were trying to manage large data sets and preserve them and be able to have different researchers use them. We actually have that situation in many conservation activities where scientific data sets are produced, and then all this ends up in a paper report, and nobody sees this data again. And there is activity going on in this area, and that's one of the most promising things we have. So what we're looking for is something that, again, is somewhat similar to something that the records management community came up with. They refer to as the records continuum, which is where you basically start your activity at the outset of the process, the moment it's created. And it's essentially the same thing as having the checkout person at the grocery store manage inventory. You know, you're actually labeling stuff from the get-go so that you know what it is. And, you know, you can do this with elaborate document management systems, but if you don't have anything, you can still use, you know, the stuff you have that's built into the program. It would really be nice if, you know, somebody popped open the properties panel in a Microsoft Word document and wrote down what the hell it was used for and what it was originally, when it was originally made and what modifications there were and so forth. This is not high tech. It's just an annoyance that you have to ask people to go through, but it may be a hurdle that you that's useful to set up because you want this to last and you want your management and your IT department to save this stuff. These are the required things that you have to do. So one of the things that, okay, I'm going to skip ahead here. There's a context. So the thing we have to concentrate is in this area of selection and appraisal. And there are a number of things that the DCC manuals provide checklists of things that you can do. One of the most interesting things, I think, here is this, the idea of essential elements when you're looking at a digital object. What is it that you're actually trying to save? Are you trying to, and that depends entirely on who you think is going to use it, who's using it now, who you think is going to use it, you know, and what useful things you can do with it in the future. You know, given that you're probably going to have to transform this material at some point in the future, what needs to go through the transformation to make this the object still work? In museums, we actually acquire digital objects, so as art pieces in a lot of cases. So this is this experiential element is sometimes a very important part of what you have to save. Do you have the ability to preserve it? Do you have the technology? This is a cost-benefit issue. And this is, of course, where digital repositories and the ability to federate and leverage scale comes into effect. Are there legal issues to consider? You know, some artworks that are acquired by museums that are digital in nature you're forbidden to do anything to them. They are supposed to degrade over time. And, you know, the gist that I want to bring this down to is that shouldn't we have been doing this stuff all along? You know, I mean, this is really what we've been talking about forever. Merging our data in museums, coordinating data among all the different producers and creators of it so that we can create this rich source of educational material. This is just one more part of that, and it involves many of the aspects of all of the digital asset management, content management that I was talking about before. This doesn't have to be done by one person. It's the kind of a function that may be incorporated into several roles. What's essential to get this to start happening is, of course, we have to start training people and educating people to make this our folks aware of this so that it happens. We have to develop policy, and we have to have clear coordination among our content managers. And that is where I'll leave it.
Well, good morning. It's great to see people up and about early in the morning. I heard from somebody that they were out like later than they expected. So I guess everyone's having a good time. So School of Information and Library Science in Chapel Hill. And we don't really do much in the area of educating folks to work in museums per se, although I would argue that most of the skills that I'm going to talk about are universally useful when somebody is dealing with digital content. So a big thank you to IMLS for giving me a bunch of money over the years to particularly work on curriculum and build a program at UNC, and to do a couple of other things. I'll talk about each of these projects a little bit, and to Diane for organizing the session. There we go again, right? In fact, this appeared the day before I was on a panel at DLF in Baltimore on the 31st. So, and that was titled Digital Curation, Digital Preservation, a couple other terms. Are we clear yet about the terms? So this was perfect. So I say, you know, once it makes the comic strips, it must be now a real term. So again, what is digital curation? And I think this is more or less the same definition. So I'm thinking we're coming to some sort of convergence about definitions from entirely different perspectives, perhaps. So this is good. It's the active management and preservation of digital resources over the life cycle of the content, whatever that content is. It's pretty agnostic. It really means you're taking care of something from cradle to grave, maybe from inception to grave. Somebody's planning to create a digital object. And, you know, the term curation, digital curation, as a term came from the UK. And I think it kind of caught on, particularly in the funding world, because a lot of people didn't like the term preservation. It was hard to get people excited about preservation. Oh, everything's about access. And it seems like, particularly in the U.S., I think we kind of sometimes throw the baby out with the bathwater. But I heard a lot of folks in the library community say, oh, we don't care about preservation, we care about access. And then after they created a lot of digital content, they said, oh, no, wait a minute, maybe we do want to keep our digital content, right? So it's preservation and access. I teach a course called Digital Preservation and Access. But I think curation takes over that term. It's not, and we were having a discussion at the beginning. So in my world, it's not connoisseurship. It's management. But it's management over the life cycle. It's not just preservation when it comes into the repository. So it's not what archivists have been doing for decades and centuries. Once you get it, you keep it the way it is. It's actually actively going out and working with people to create better objects, and then keeping them over that useful life cycle. And that working with the content creator part of it is, I think, for many archivists, revolutionary. Okay, so every audience that uses this term has something to complain about with the term, I think. Okay, so education in this area can range from general awareness of, like, what is this? And some of you may be here today just at that level. It can be that for the public. Library of Congress has done, once a year they do a personal digital archiving kind of day, which falls into this category, how people are keeping their own stuff. A lot of that is just awareness raising, all the way through people getting PhD degrees in information library science, but this focusing on digital curation. There's the wonderful model, and there are lots of life cycle models, by the way, that break it up in different ways. Again, the objects in here and then all sorts of things are kind of wrapped around that. I think we focus mostly on that outside ring, so it's really not as complex as you might think it is. Again, from conceptualization of the object all the way around to using it, somebody else reusing it, which of course has always been the case in archives, where historians, for example, as one audience, would come in and use personal papers that had just the articles and the output, but the data. Then somebody else comes along and uses that very same data without recollecting it, which is the expensive part, frequently, reanalyzing it, saving costs along the way, and coming up with different findings, exploring it in a different way. So again, it's not just preservation for preservation's sake. It's not just access. It's that whole management that brings people to creative reuse of the content originally. So today I'm going to talk about a little bit of context about the projects I've been involved with and where we've come out with educational tools and what's been going on at the Library of Congress, Society of American Archivists, and then a shot in the dark on what skills curators need. Digital curators. Maybe that's God. I just said curators. That's right. I didn't say digital curator. Website, at least the framework of that. Two international symposia where we had about almost 300 people to each one of those, which was amazing. And people have asked me if I put on another one. So one of the things we learned was that was a lot of work. And the third one was the Digital Carolina Digital Curation Fellowship Program. So we had five students that we kind of tried out the curriculum on. They were getting a free ride, so they had to work for that in terms of giving us some evaluation. And they were working on internships at the time, so they actually had a hands-on component. And much of what I'm going to talk about later comes from that project. Currently, we're working on the follow-on to that, which is also IMLS funded. And this involves National Archives and the University of Toronto. Runs through 13. Here, we're educating PhD students. And we've built the Digital Curation Exchange, which is a site where you can go and learn about digital curation. Groups, it's a Drupal site, post information, post jobs, things like that. And we've been running summer institutes, at least the major portion of them are in the summer, week-long institutes, followed up with a session held in January, first week of January. And the fourth one will be held next May in Chapel Hill. And our third symposium called Curate Gear, and I have a few slides about that, will be on January 6th of coming up. And then we've had a PhD seminar series. This is what the Digital Curation Exchange looks like. So you can, depending on which groups you belong to, these screens will change, but you can have a focus on various functions and so on and so forth. So for our master's students, we have a concentration in archives and records management. That is not strictly digital curation by any means, but the interesting thing is I have not been teaching the intro for a number of years, and I'm watching my colleague this semester, Cal Lee, teach it, and I'm going to be teaching it in the spring, so the two of us are going to be doing that. 10 years ago, you started with you assumed analog, you assumed paper, and you had a day or two when you talked about digital resources. Today, that's flipped. That really, everything you talk about is managing digital content, and then on the side, how you manage paper content. So it really, our world has changed, and as Chuck pointed out, we have gone to a society that is probably 99% digital in the sense of what we're creating today. It's just amazing. We have a certificate in digital curation that sits on top of our degree. So that's three extra courses. And we have a dual master's with either of our master's degree and our School of Government with the MPA. That's the ASOPI project where folks are learning to be hopefully digital curators or policy folks in the kind of the IT realm that can influence public administration policy. We have 10 or more PhD students in the area, and the DigiSeeker Professional Institute and some other workshops. So two of the primary tools that I think are the most useful for thinking about what folks need to know. So this was our task from the beginning. How are we going to build a curriculum if we didn't have some sort of structure or framework? So this matrix is a tool for thinking about planning for identifying and organizing material to be covered in the curriculum. We don't cover it all. No one is going to learn all of the stuff that could be included. No one's going to learn about all of the different environments where you're going to work. No one's going to learn about all the different technical things. I think every school that works in this area will produce a slightly different flavor, but we're looking for a core out of this and then what that structure looks like. So all digital curation students should get should all get some aspects of the curriculum. And this has six dimensions, mandates, values, and principles, professional disciplinary context, so that might be an archives, library, museum, how you're moving from one point in the information continuum or life cycle transition point to the next. That's usually when you're doing something to content. Otherwise, it's kind of sitting there. Types of resources, function or skill, and prerequisite knowledge. So, to make it a little less abstract, those are those six areas again, and our explanation of what those actually are. So the function and skills is what I'm going to talk about probably the most today. The know-how, as opposed to the conceptual attitude, Millard, declarative knowledge. I think, particularly coming out of the archives field, but I think libraries, museums, and archives, there's a great connection to the values, mandates, and principles, the core reasons why digital curation functions and skills should be carried out. So I think that's always underlying what we're teaching, is why we're doing it. Okay. And, for example, taking that aspect of the matrix, these are the kind of things that we make sure that we cover someplace in our curriculum. Okay. I think the part that people probably are the most interested in is looking at the high-level functions, where we talk about things like system engineering and development, selection, appraisal, and disposition. A little definition, and then one of these sub-functions underneath this. So when you kind of break down all of the things people do in this domain, we come up with this rather hefty list of things. I'll come back to that in just a bit. Closing the Digital Curation Gap Project, and I was here last year. Last year was Austin?
Yep.
Yes, okay. I was at Austin with Heather Bowden and Cal Lee, and we were doing a focus group to figure out what folks in the museum field needed to have in terms of digital curation resources, and we're actually building some of these tools for libraries, archives, and museums. So we did focus groups across those three audiences at different professional organizations. And again, we're partnering here with IMLS because it's a cooperative agreement and the Joint Information Systems Committee in the UK. And we're focusing on building tools for small and medium-sized cultural heritage institutions. So it's not going to be a software tool that's going to help you ingest something, but we've come to call them now getting going guides to get people going. Where do I look for information? What are the first steps that I take? Okay. parallel to this, Library of Congress Digital Preservation Outreach and Education Program, DPO, has a website at Library of Congress, www.digitalpreservation.gov. And the model that they have come up with in terms of conducting workshops and they've started to conduct, I was one of the instructors in one in September, is the notion that, so I was tasked with the idea of what skills do people need to have. Well, there isn't one set of skills for all levels of people who are going to be working in this area. So I think they very nicely in this diagram talk about executive level staff, you know, the resource allocators in your institution that need that executive summary and be able to understand that and why you want funding for whatever it is that you're preserving in your museum. Managerial kind of level, project planning types of workshops and webinars, and then the hands-on material for folks who are actually doing the preservation and access.
No.
So side of America, archivists in the last year have done much the same thing. They've come up with a digital archives curriculum and a certificate program. And kind of using what we did at UNC and at Library of Congress, they've come up with foundational courses that are the basic skills, tactical and strategic courses, tools and services that focus on specific tools. There are a lot of tools out there, and it's pretty hard to be overwhelmed. It's pretty easy to be overwhelmed by the number of tools and what do they do and how do you make them work together. And then transformational courses that are more broad in scope and looking at how do I move my organization from here, from this analog organization to a more digital one. Okay, so what did we find out? Students need to have a holistic view of the digital curation picture, but they would need to remain flexible in moving between jobs and environments because they're going to be different in different organizations and different collaborations and